In this video, I'm going to tell you the top 5 subjective and objective signs and symptoms of clinical lumbar instability. Hi and welcome back to Physiotutors. When we are talking about clinical lumbar instability, we are running into two problems. First of all, there is no clear definition of what lumbar instability actually is, and most often it is related to an enlarged neutral zone based on the concept of Panjabi. And second of all, there is no golden standard to measure this increased neutral zone, so we also don't have any validated clinical tests to confirm or reject lumbar instability. Therefore, the best tool we have is a Delphi study done by Cook et al. In the year 2006, who asked experts in the field for the top clinical signs and symptoms of clinical lumbar instability. So here we go. The top 5 subjective factors, starting with the most mentionings, are: number 1, the feeling of giving way or giving out. Number 2, frequent self-manipulation or the frequent need to crack or pop one's back. Number 3, frequent bouts of episodes of symptoms. Number 4, a history of painful catching or locking during twisting movements or bending movements of the spine. And number 5, pain during transitional activities, for example, sit to stand. So now let's look at the top 5 objective factors in clinical lumbar instability. Number 1 is poor lumbopelvic control, including segmental hinging or pivoting with movement, as well as poor proprioceptive function. Number 2, poor coordination or neuromuscular control, including juddering or shaking. Number 3 is decreased strength and endurance of local muscles at the level of the segmental instability. Number 4 is aberrant movement, including changing lateral shift during lumbar active range of motion. And at last, we have pain with sustained positions and postures. If you want to see the whole list of all signs and symptoms that were named, you can find the link to the article of Cook et al. In the description down below. Always remember not to create a nocebo and to tell your patient that he has an unstable back or similar. You could rather tell him that you are trying to figure out if an exercise program could be an option for him. Alright, this was our video on the top 5 subjective and objective signs and symptoms of clinical lumbar instability. Logically, you would think that a patient who exhibits a big part of these signs and symptoms will benefit from a stabilization program. Watch our video on the clinical prediction rule by Hicks et al., who can help you determine if your patient is likely to benefit from such a program.